I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. Also, since I'm speaking to a new audience, I tend to mumble a lot. So if I mumble, ask me to repeat what I'm saying. If you didn't follow that, I'm not sure what to do. But so this is a this is not really related to large deviations, but I think the large deviations questions for this operator is still to be understood. So this is joint work with Kaushik Ramachandran, who's now a postdoc at Oklahoma State. So I'll be a little pedantic. I'll just state the model and the main results, and then after that I'll try and explain where it sits in the literature. So the model is the following. I'll always work with Euclidean space, dimensions bigger than 3. Less than 3 one can do. The semantics of the Green function will change, but the paper is only for this particular dimensions. So we consider the operator F given by the specific form. So it's got a sort of a reversible diffusion coming along. So that's typically written like this. Aij F. That's the continuous part of the diffusion. And plus it has a jump term, which makes it non-local. That's so let's say at x, but the jump term is rd minus 0. So you look at particles from, okay, so I think I should write it as jump from y to x according to a specified jump measure. It has density. I'll write it as jxy dy. So that's the operator. So I'll try and give examples to see where this operator sits in. So the crucial fact you'd keep in mind is that this is a non-local operator. So what happens very, very far away affects what's, because the jump function affects the value of L. And F is suitable so that this object is well defined. So let me just state the assumption. So let's say I'll take Q and Aijs to be functions from Rd to the real line, and J to be a function from Rd cross Rd. I haven't told you what Q is. I'll come in a second to the real line again. And I'll make some assumptions on A. So here are my assumptions. Let's say so. So the assumption on A is that it's uniformly elliptic. So if you that just means that it's strictly positive in sense. So I'll just assume that also further, because of the way I've defined the operator, I'll need some smoothness conditions on the coefficients Aij, and I'll have lambda times mod psi squared is less than summation I and j equal to 1 to d aij of x, xi I, xij less than equal to lambda inverse, let's say, squared. I need this for all xi and x and rd. So standard assumption one makes in PDEs, but I'll just sort of, I'll explain where all this sits in a second, but I'll assume the jump measure, the jump, it can be a little bit more general than what I'm stating, but for the sake of this talk, I think I can just say that it's non-negative, it's symmetric, so it means you jump from x to y, the rate is the same as jumping from y to x, and it's a measurable function, because I need to integrate it. And I'll think of it close to alpha stable, okay? So I'll think of it as close. So I'll say such that there exists C positive, alpha in 0, 2. So the alpha stable jump function looks like a constant divided by x minus y to the d plus alpha. So I'll think of my J as being sort of bounded below and above by an alpha stable. So let's say C1 inverse, let's say. That's the thing. Of course, for all x not equal to y. So, okay, so this is so the idea is that this the jump is like alpha stable, but it can be a little bit more general than that. You can vary this a little bit, but I, as of now, I'll just leave it like this. Then the so I'm thinking of Schrodinger operator with respect to L. So I'll have a function q. So I'll call the assumption as Q. So Q is what's called Q is in Kato class. So I'll assume that the limit as epsilon goes to zero, integral of the. So I need a supremum. So let's say a supremum over all x and R d. So globally around, I look at a radius of epsilon around x, and I integrate this function Q with what Frank called the Newtonian potential, so I have to have an absolute value dy. I'll have it to be zero. So this is as yet no. Exactly right. Yeah, I'm just going to the Schrodinger operator with L, and the Q is the Schrodinger operator. Yeah. So this is the Kato class. Okay. So this is the. So I've thrown the assumptions at you. I'll throw the main result as well before I sort of. So the main result is the following. So it's a Harnack inequality for the Schrodinger operator. So so you let R be in so positive 0, 1 half. X naught is in RD. You assume A, Q, A, J, and Q holds. Suppose I have a differentiable function, let's say it's non-negative, and solves the Schrodinger operator. So LU plus QU equal to 0 in the ball of radius R around X naught. Then inside a smaller set, the solutions compare. So then they exist. So this is constant is important, C1. C1 doesn't depend on U, it depends on R, depends on the lambda, depends on the C, depends on the on Q. I'll put a little Q here, such that U of X is less than equal to C times C1 times U of Y for all X, Y, in a smaller ball around R. Okay, so that's the. This is what's called the Harnack inequality. So. And this is what's called the typically. I don't know how physicists call it, but at least in math literature, it's called the Schrodinger operator associated to L. So. Okay, so that's the result. So I'll try and now work towards establishing why the result's important and how to prove it. That's the, and where it's used and so on and so forth. So let me just... Yeah, so the solution U is a solution of LU plus QU equal to zero. And I'm establishing a Harnack inequality for solutions of this equation. Right? So U solves LU plus QU equal to zero, and in this ball, and this one. That's right, generator is just a jump diffusion. It moves continuously like this, and the jump part is like this, that's right. I've done everything I want, but I'm not sure. Let's see. So, LU plus Q times U is a genuine operator. I'm looking at solutions of this equal to zero, and I'm showing that they satisfy Harnack inequality. That's the result. Q times U. So LU equal to 0 would be the harmonic function with respect to U, and L plus Q times U equal to 0 is the cylindrical. Right. So okay, so maybe the result is kind of small. So all I'm saying is that I'm presenting a harmonic inequality for solutions to the equation. That's all I'm doing, so this result. And interpretations of why Q comes in is that, let's say Q has the same sign, Q is positive, let's say, then it's a killing rate, and so on and so forth. That's all. We'll see. This L. Is that what? Okay, so now it's okay. Also, after teaching all these years, I repeat myself with a tape recorder, so I don't understand the question as well. I just repeat, so I'm so sorry about that. Small Q is a function. It's a function. Right? It's a function from R D to R. So Q and A J are. Yeah, given function. That's right. Yeah, given function. Q, A, I, J, and J are given functions. Satisfy A, J, and Q, and I take a solution L U plus Q equal to 0, and I just unlike it. So. Well, that also looked like Q. I didn't realize that. Okay, let's do some examples so that this whole thing becomes a little clearer, so that we know where we are. And I'll try and tell you where this sort of sits in the literature in some sense. So let's do a very simple case. Let's take J to be 0, so the non-local part disappears. Let's take A to be identity. So AI J is equal to 0 for I not equal to J, and AI J is equal to 1 for AII is equal to 1. Let's say. So take the identity. So then the operator L reduces to the Laplacian. Right? So standard Laplacian. Let's do one small thing. Let's just take Q autos to be 0. So in fact, L plus Q is just the Laplacian. Right? So L plus Q is just the Laplacian. So this is just the classic Harnack inequality for harmonic functions that's been well known. So in fact, it was shown by Harnack in 1887. I didn't realize it until Kaushik told me that Harnack was part of a twins, apparently. So the twin brother. And the second brother who didn't prove the inequality is more famous. There's an award after him as well, apparently. So I do not know this. The way I look at this is not analytically. The way one looks at it is that, suppose you have a domain. Let me draw the domain here. So I have a domain like this, a domain D, and I have Laplacian U is equal to 0 inside, and U is equal to phi on the boundary. I'd always think of my solutions as U of X as the average of a Brownian path as it exits the boundary. So that's how I would think of the solutions. So I would think, if I have a point X here, I would wait for the Brownian path to exit the domain, and this is the point X tau D, and I would average over all possible values of the exit distribution, and that would give me my solution. And that's how I understand it. And the Harnack inequality is then very powerful probabilistically, because it tells you, if I look at solutions in the ball around X, and I want to see for points in the ball, are the exit probabilities around a certain set comparable? The Harnack inequality says they are comparable. So that's something that's very powerful, which we'll use. So this was shown very early on using analytic techniques, and the proof is very nice and very simple. It's even available on Wikipedia, perhaps. So let's just go a little step. When Q is not zero, so this is the first case of Q is zero. When Q is not zero, this becomes the true Schrodinger operator, with L plus Q becomes Laplace plus Q. And in this case, probabilistic loss is a nice interpretation. The solution just becomes comes up with the Feynman-Cox term on the top. So it's like integral 0 to tau d, Q of x s ds, and then U of phi of x tau d, in the way I've written it this way, in this setting. Right? So since I have not specified boundary values in my problem, I will just say, I'll just put a U here instead of that. So that way it's clear. So it's just the average of the U values in the boundary. And tau D, if I've not defined it, is just the first time the process exits the domain. So this was shown in 1982 by Eisenman and Simon using an analytic approach. And of course, there have been probabilistic approaches of how to do this since then. That's outlined in a beautiful book by Kai Leitch and Zhao in 94, I think. So there's a whole book on this operator. It explains how to define this properly. And a little bit of impreciseness in my statement, because I have to say that the time is, exit time hasn't happened yet, but broadly, that's the philosophy. So now these are two examples that many of you may have seen before. Now let's go to the other extreme. So this is one example, second example. The third example I'd like to go is the other extreme. So I cloak my diffusion part at completely zero. I take my jump part to be stable alpha. So G of XY is CD alpha mod X minus Y to the D minus alpha, D plus alpha. So that means the process just jumps. So it doesn't have a continuous motion. Let me draw this in green. Let me call this. So this process just sort of stays at some point and then jumps somewhere else and so on and so forth. And the problem immediately becomes different because now when this person exits the domain, it exits continuously. When this person exits the domain, it might jump very, very far away. So the problem will depend on the complement of the domain in a very non-trivial way. The continuous part only depends on the boundary, depend on complement. So in this sense, then L, if this is J, then L becomes what I would call as the fractional Laplacian. And this was shown by Ries in 1930s result about the Harnack inequality. But let's take Q equal to zero again. This was Ries in using. So there's a sort of a Poisson kernel representation for this process, and you can use it to show the Harnack inequality. So when Q is not zero, then this took a while. It was very recently, maybe in early 2000 by Bogdan and the second name I can't pronounce, so I'll write it down. Again, the proof here is probabilistic. It's 0,0 to 0,6. And in this region, it was resolved for when L Laplace and alpha by 2 plus QU is equal to 0. So for this operator. Okay, so that's the two extremes. So 3 and 4 are the two extremes when the process is only moving with a diffusion constant and or moving with a sort of a Laplacian. And general A was done by, I'll tell you what happened general A and general J soon, but fundamentally the ideas are around these sort of four works in that sense. Yeah, pure J. No Q0. Pure J. It's just a plasma. It took a while for the Schrodinger thing to come. So let me just close here. L in its current form. I'll switch gears a little bit. So I'll take L in current form. So L in current form. And Q is zero. This was done very recently by Chen and Kumagai in 2011. And independently by Foon Doon in 2010, I guess. So they showed a Harnack inequality for just the operator with Q equal to zero. Okay, so that's what's done. No, L as stated and Q zero. So just the not the Schrodinger operator, but just the operator L equal to zero. So they established a Harnack inequality for this. The techniques in both were different. Here they give very strong, say for example, like the way I have stated, one thing we must sort of, the way I've stated the problem, my operator L is kind of very, very close to the following operator. So, I mean, it's not quite close, but so I have a Laplacian and I have a Laplacian alpha by 2 And because of my assumptions, I'm kind of close to some A times this plus B times this. I'm not quite that, but I'm quite close to that. Okay. Because my A's are bounded, so I throw them away. So they're like Laplacian, and my J is bound, like stable alpha, so it's like this. So it's a combination of the two things. This has been worked on by several authors, Zhenqin Chen, Renming Song, Punky Kim, and Wondersec. So this is a work in the, from a lot of work in 2011 to 2016 on this particular operator. So again, the advantage of this operator is the following, that your diffusion and your jump part are independent. They're not, your jump is going along and your jump is going along and diffusion is happening. Here in this operator, the there's strong interactions. So where I am at X determines how I'm jumping, and similarly here. So the strong interaction between the jump part and the diffusion part. So if you think a little bit, this particular operator, you can rewrite it as a Brownian subordinator. So you just you let the Brownian motion run, and at some subordinator, you sort of extend this. So you can use this idea to analyze this process. But you can't use the same idea to analyze this thing. Of course, given my assumptions, I'm kind of thinking like this, but it's not quite that. So, right. So a harnack inequality, typically you state it in a ball. You say a ball of radius r, and then radius r by 2. That's all you typically do that. It's a local property. So you have harmonicity inside the ball, and you say, okay, inside a smaller ball, you have a comparison solutions. So I was asked this question by Suresh Kumar. He's a professor in IIT Bombay, and they work in something called risk sensitive control. So apparently, in this area, the harnack inequality for L plus Q was very much needed. I take very little risks over the years. I'm very insensitive. I have no control over myself, so I have no idea what's going on. So, apparently, it's very useful in that area. So that's why we start doing this. We thought that it would just follow from this result in a very simple way, but it became a 45-page tumor. So what's the difficulty here? The difficulty here is that this process associated to L, if I look at this X, so what will happen is it will move around, and then it'll move around. It'll have two parts, a continuous part and a diffusion part. So whenever it's moving the diffusion part, it'll move like this, and suddenly it'll jump. So it'll jump to another point, and then another point again, it'll move around, and then maybe it'll jump here. And then when it exits, it has two possibilities. It can exit via the continuous part, or it can exit via the jump part. Okay, so it has two ways of exiting the domain. So the harmonic measure becomes very, very non-trivial to understand. So I'll give you the proof outline, and then I'll close with some ideas about what problems are left to understand this thing. So here's the proof outline. So this was followed. I'm just following the same idea as how Cranston, Fabs, and Zhao did it when J was zero. This is the proof for J0. I'll write the proof down, and I'll explain the difficulties of implementing their idea, and I'll sort of close with that. So how does one do this? So the first thing, like I said, you take X and Y in this smaller ball, right? And then you do this. You write the solution down. So U of X is the same as X squared value starting at X, e to the minus this Feynman-Crux correction term, Q of X as ds, U of X star p. Right. That's the problem representation, right? So then what you do is you have to condition on the exit measure. So you look at how you got out. You got out this way, I got out that way. So once you do that, if you just believe me a little bit, this is just the same thing as, so if I condition exit measure, this person is measurable, so it stays outside. So this will give me it'll give me EX. Then I'll have EX, if I use the Markov property, EX, X tau B, and of course this jump process, so I'll take a minus E to the minus 0 tau B Q of X as DS, and then I'll I'll close this, and then I have a U of X tau B outside, right? So this is how I look at it. And what is this thing? This is a measure of the following kind. So what's EXY? So that's just look at a domain again. This is a ball. You start at a point X, your point Y, and thing. You look at the path that is conditioned to end at Y and die at Y. So it's a condition law. Then it's classical. It's well known that this is what's called a conditional gauge theorem that you can show. That these people are all bounded. Either they are fine at infinity everywhere or they're bounded. So these are bounded below and above by constants. Or they're infinity. This functional is infinity across the domain, or it's bounded by two constants. And this assumption Q will ensure that they are finite. Okay, so the function is finite at one point. So what will happen is that using this, I would just get this is less than EX. Let's say I get C2 from this. I'll put the yellow here. I'll keep the color so it's easy. So C2, I'll get EX U of X tau B. So now you go back here again. Now E of X U X tau B just solves LU equal to 0. So I use the Harnack inequality given by either of these people. So I'll get this less than equal to. I'll keep my C2 here. I'll get a C, and I'll get EY U of X tau B. This is Harnack from of LU equal to 0 from Chen or right. Once I do this, So there's sort of a general conditional gauge theory that says that this EXY measure, either it's infinity throughout or has the property of being C1 and C2. So all I have to show it to you that it's not infinity out. So that I show by assumption Q, I just integrate the green function out, it just comes out. Once I have this, then I go back to this yellow guy again, I apply the lower bound, so I get this less than equal to C2 is in yellow again from the lower people, C3 hands around, and I get 1 over C1, and then inside, I just repeat the whole thing back. So I just get EX, EY, X tau B minus, e to the minus 0 to tau B, Q of X as DS, and then U of X tau B. So I'm just doing C1 again. This is less than 1, so this is less than 1. So I just put. And then I'm done. So then I go back, and this is the same as U at Y. So the same as less than equal to some C4. Let's say C4 times U at Y. Okay. So in the this is the broad strategy of how to do this project. The proof is very simple. It's just got these four steps, and you're done. Of course, now the trouble is in the details, and so I'll just explain in the last 10 minutes what all you have to be careful about. Okay, so let's say you're just in the Brownian motion case. Just forget about let's say you're in example one, example let's say two. So where Laplacian plus Q. So then X tau B minus is just the point at which only this sort of setting will occur. And then you can understand the conditional measure of Brownian motion quite well. You can write it down precisely, like an H transform. There's a Martin kernel available for you, and that'll give you the estimates for free. And you can implement this project correctly. But otherwise, you have to go back and do everything by scratch. So if you want to do this, even if you're in this setting, it's a little easier because you're a Brownian subordinator. So and then you can work with the Brownian motion again to get it done. But once you have interactions, you're sort of the details become quite hard to do. It's the pathway is there, but we had to show a Carlson estimate by hand for this operator because you had to understand the exit measure. So this is towards understanding exit measure. So how does this measure look like? so you understand how this looks like. So this is supported both on the boundary as well as the complement. So you understand this. So you need a Carlson estimate for this. You'll need a boundary Harnack principle for this operator. This is all for L. You'll need a 3G estimate, which is a sort of very standard in showing this to this, if you look at Chung and Zhao's book. And understanding this, finally, once you have three ingredients, there's a standard way to understand the Martin boundary of this process. So once you do all this, once you have all these ingredients, then you can implement this program. It's a straightforward program. And the conditional gauge theorem is available for you. It's available in a very general setting. You can once you understand this measure of the process starting at X and how it, where it exits. So it can either exit from a point outside or can exit on the boundary. Once you understand that Martin boundary of that, this whole process is stable. So it's, the techniques are available for you, and you can work it out. So you have to sort of sit and write this down. This is where we cheated. You can always compare your operator with an operator like this because of the assumptions that I have. And that's how the proof sort of finishes off. So the idea is that you need this sort of these tables to sort of finish this program out. Okay, I have 3 minutes left. So I'll say one more thing. I think this operator is very interesting in its own right, regardless of the way I sort of motivated it. This interaction is itself is one issue that I said. So any of the programs that Frank mentioned in his previous talk is very hard to implement. So you look at a trap model, for example, with the particles moving with L, or you look at, let's say, even the polaron problem from classical days. Any parabolic Anderson model idea with this operator. What makes it harder is A, the interaction. B is there is no scaling available to you. Like this scales like R squared, this scales like R to the alpha. So there's no one scaling available. So example, I think in the previous lecture, it was immediately said, it doesn't matter what the radius of the ball around the sausage is. You can always take R equal to 1. You can't do it here, because scaling is different. And I think Kaushik and I tried now to get the idea of Spitzer's result, where you get this, the rate function is the principal eigenvalue. And that seems quite hard as well, because there's no universal scaling available to you. Each one scales differently, but locally you're in good shape because your jump is like stable alpha. So nearby you'll be like a diffusion for some time. So you have a certain scaling, and when you jump, you have jump certain scaling. So you can work in two time scales. You have to work a little harder to get this program across, but it should be doable given the strong assumptions that I've placed. Also now, after this result, you have transient densities that have Gaussian bounds. So you can work with that as well. So it's not stable bounds, at least in the large time scale, in the small time scale. In the large time scale, again, you have stable alpha, but... And there is no analytic proof of the result. I've talked to a bunch of analysts. Non-local operators, they all run away from because there's no maximum principle. Because the thing depends on outside the domain, not only the boundary. So they all run away from it. So as of now, there's only this complicated probabilistic proof. There should be some super solution, sub-solution idea, but I don't know how to do this. There are two surveys that are quite nice to read on these topics. There's one by Maurice Kassmann in 2007, he traverses the history of the Harnack inequality. Pretty much my example slide, he translates completely until L. Then for applications of Harnack inequality for probabilistic ideas, I think along with this book, I would recommend something like Bass's book on, it's called Probability Technique Analysis in 98. So these are there, they use this Harnack inequality for quantum motion very extensively and tell you lots of properties of it.
So as you indeed point out, so the difficulty is that you have two objects that are scaled differently.
That's right.
Somehow you would expect that the scaling of the second one is sort of the dominant one.
Right.
And if you would apply that, you would see all sorts of tiny little pieces of diffusion.
That's right.
Would that mean that you would need to have some sort of refined Harnack inequality on a smaller scale.
That's right. Yeah, see that. That's right. Exactly right. Yeah. You have to do that. Exactly right. Okay. Absolutely. Yeah. And this, if you do this chain of balls argument like they do for any domain, that will explode very quickly because the constant is this blowing is like quite large. Like, you're right. Absolutely right. Yeah, right.
Okay. I see.
Oh yeah. So, general J, I for general J, I don't know how to implement that idea, but. For this set, it's okay, right? So that's all I meant as approximation and work. I don't think for general J you can. I don't think so. I don't think so. And I said general fractal Laplace because of this assumption. So of course, this is too strong. You just need a sort of symmetric integrable measure. It is too strong. Yeah.
Thanks, Steve.